Ray, we're going to have a special memorial service for the homeless. It's important that the homeless are remembered, isn't it?
Yes, it is. I think that they feel that they're forgotten. And, you know, when we hold this memorial services, the living homeless that are with us, I think it means a lot to them because they know that they're not forgotten. Of course, we don't want to wait till after they die to memorialize them. We want to help them now, and that's what we're trying to do. But it means a lot for these people to know that they are not the castaways of our society, that we love them and God loves them, but they're not going to know that God loves them unless they see it through people. And so that's why it's so vital that we do this.
I want to invite you to join us at this memorial service held on December the 29th in front of the 1411 Locust Building here in the city of St. Louis. The purpose of this gathering is that so no one thinks that they're totally forgotten if they're on the streets. It's easy to feel like you're all alone. It's easy to feel like if you just to drop somewhere, nobody would even know that you were there. But you are important. You're a child of God. And it's so ironic, we had this picture taken back in April of the police telling Denise that she couldn't sleep on that vacant lot right across from Biddle House. Some of you know what they're talking about.
Yeah, you were there. Yeah, I know, I was there.
So, and they told you that. They told others of you that. Here's some of these flyers for those that didn't get that, or you can help pass that out. And we want you to look over the list. And if you're there, you may know somebody that's passed. You may know someone that's passed. Well, we're going to have a word of prayer here in just a moment. And we want to ask you just to join us in prayer because we want to work to see that your name's not on the list next year, okay?
Yeah.
And we want you to be praying that we can get back into 1411 Locust Street, all right?
Yeah.
It's very, very important. So let's have a word of prayer right now, okay? Father God, we remember these that have come before you. We remember, Lord Jesus, that you said that foxes have holes and birds have nests, but you, the Son of Man, had nowhere to lay your head. We had the statue of the homeless Jesus over here, Lord, to remind us of the fact that you're among the homeless. And these are your children, and we commit them unto you. And Lord, we come to you with these that remain homeless on the streets. We intercede and pray that you'll open 1411 Locust first by day and then by night. And dear God, we ask that you would pour your Spirit out on each one right here. And if any do not feel that they have direction, purpose for their life, or they don't feel loved, Lord, just receive them right now in a very special, powerful way. Receive them. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God loves you. He's got a purpose for your life. Joining me is Pastor Ray Redlich, Pastor Mark Glenn. And they're out on the streets. Ray's back over here. He found from some of the homeless that these individuals had died. Ray, could you come up and join us just a moment up here and tell us a little bit about the ones that died on Christmas?
Both the Winter Patrol volunteers that found are here.
Okay, what is that?
Both the Winter Patrol volunteers are here.
And where are they now?
One is over there.
Can our Winter Patrol volunteers come up here?
Joe and Mike.
Joe and Mike that found Denise. Come on up here, Joe, Mike. We thank God for the Winter Patrol volunteers, that these guys have been helping us for years, going out on the streets, working with Pastor Ray, and we just want to talk to them just a moment. Come on up here a minute, fellas. I think you guys were the ones that first recognized or found. Tell us what happened when you found Denise, or what happened. Somebody want to speak up and tell us?
So we've been taking care of Denise now for over a year. As many of you guys know, Denise has been in and out of treatment thanks to Sister Crystal, you know, really looking to try to get off the streets. You know, Denise, she struggled. Her main focus was to try to get clean for her daughter. Everybody wants, you know, hope out here, and that was our biggest thing. And Denise struggled with that part of it. Out here, you know, Denise did everything she could to try to find herself and to find her way off of heroin. And that's something that it's taken many lives of our brothers and sisters that are out here. We found Denise right around the corner in the old car school there. Denise had been laid there for approximately 5 days by herself. So, you know, it breaks my heart. For all of you guys that I know out here on these streets, we don't want to find you there. We don't want you alone. We don't want to find that, you know, 5 days that you've laid by yourself, you know, with the needle next to your arm or anything else like that. You know, there are a lot of us out here that's willing to help you, and there's a lot of help that's available. You know, and it breaks my heart that we had a sister that laid on the streets for that many days with no one there. Who knows how long she would have laid there before somebody found her. But we were blessed. God had us. He knew exactly where she was at, and he led us to her. And that's exactly how we found her in that building. So to all of you guys, you know, it's about taking care of one another. We can't do it alone. Each and every one of you, this is your family. You know, whether you're a homeless family or you're a street outreach family, this is your family. And we have to take care of one another. And we can't leave our brothers and sisters dying on the streets the way they're dying.
Thank you very much. And that's why we want to pray that we get back into 1411 Locust so that those that are struggling, like Denise, that are out there, that we can be able to offer them that kind of support. Did anybody else want to say something from the team? Oh, okay. Would you like to, sister,
Crystal,
come right? Crystal.
I'd like Crystal to say something. Okay. Crystal actually, you know, she's worked with Denise for a long time in the recovery.
And there's others that are on this list, too, that we're remembering, too, today.
I love Denise a lot. I was homeless when I met her. We were both in addiction. And God was kind, and he delivered me. And now I run a recovery house for addicts who want to leave addiction. My husband has my card. We don't have enough space for everybody here. But if you're sincere and wanting to leave addiction and turn to Jesus Christ, we can help. I found Denise dead the first time I found her. And I scooped her up and I brought her to the recovery house. She did a cold turkey detox there. And she lasted for 3 weeks before she came in and told me that she just wanted to use one more time and she'd come back. I found her almost dead the second time. She was in a snowstorm without clothes on the concrete. So I picked her up and I brought her home again. She made it clean 2.5 weeks that time before once again she told me she wanted to get high just one more time. There's no more Denise here today. I just want to encourage each one of you. There are a large number of people here that are willing to help you. I battled addiction for years and years and years, and it took me asking for help. Sometimes that one more time can be our last time, as it was for Denise. She, in all sincerity, the last time I saw her was telling me about housing and rehab and her daughter. She was just going to get high one more time, and now she's gone. There's a lot of people here today that are willing to help you. I have cards, Joe Burke. There are people here who will help you get clean. I personally will help you get clean. We don't have to lose our lives this way. I just pay honor to Denise. I loved her very dearly, and I know she'll be greatly missed by all of us.
Yes, thank you very much. Come right up here a little bit. As she mentioned, if they don't have room, ladies, we have the safe houses for you all. Pastor Ray here will get you guys in a training program, and then we'll transfer you into that, because that's what we're trying to do, is work together with all these agencies, because we don't want to see anybody die out there.
Hi, my name's Pastor Tina Crawford. I met Denise a few years ago when I started my advocacy work, and she was just a spitfire, you know, just full of gumption. She touched so many people's lives and so many hearts. I mean, it just amazes me. It's sad to lose anyone to addiction. We've lost too many. I'm and myself in recovery 17 years by the grace of God. But I don't want to take today and mourn her loss. She is something, and we all loved her, and she mattered to all of us. So will you all stand up and clap, and let's celebrate her life.
Thank you. I'm going to have a seat a moment here. I'm going to ask Pastor Ray to come up here. Ray, tell us a little bit about Derek, Darren, Roy, what you know about Derek, Darren.
Well, I was told that he died in a vacant yard in the area where the various warehouses, that he was found dead. And they told me that his pockets had been turned inside out, which is a sad commentary. No, not only to die out on the streets, but then to be robbed when you die. So we don't know. I'm not sure the circumstances of his death. Well, the last I heard, the medical examiner had not finished their report yet. But he's just one of many people that would be forgotten if we didn't remember them now and also try to help others like them, like Derek and the many others on this list, to intervene in their lives, to let them know that that they're important to us. They're important to God. Let them know by our presence, by our help, by our encouragement. We need to be out there with the people, helping them. And that's what we want to continue to do. And we want to get this building open that people can have a place to come to, because that's so important. You know, the question is, maybe Denise would have come here. Maybe Derek would have been sleeping in this building if it had been open.
Right.
But the city has closed us down so that we are barred from taking people in. We're barred from offering the help that people so desperately need. So we ask for your prayers that we can continue to get this building open, for your efforts to continue to badger the mayor and let her know that you want to be able to help people. You want to be able to have private organizations like New Life Evangelistic Center that are independent of city control to continue to help people. It's not just a few shelters like the Biddle House, which are insufficient. I just talked to a lady a few minutes ago, one of the ladies right here, that said that she's been calling almost every day to get into the existing shelters, and they're always full. But praise God, we want to get this building open. We can help so many more people in such greater ways if we could do that. You wouldn't have to be sitting out in the cold right now yourselves if we had our building open.
Keep us in your prayers. Mark Lynn, real quick. Yeah. Mark is going to come share with you. We want you ladies to know that we've just opened a couple more safe houses for the women right now. So if you need a place, please talk to Mark here, talk to Ray. Men, there's training programs open, and these ladies just brought up how they're trying to help people need treatment. Go ahead.
What about the men, man? Open some up for the men. You say open up for the men. What about me?
We got some open for the. Okay, let's do it.
Okay, so the name on here is Bobby Lee Barrow. And most of you know him by the nickname of Midnight.
Yeah.
And I remember Midnight. He always greeted me with a smile. He was always very, very nice. I remember one night when Reverend Ray and I was out on homeless patrol, and we caught a flat tire, and we were near Midnight's Vaco that he stayed in. And he came out, and he helped us fix that flat tire. And so I remember him being a generous person, and I'm sorry that his life ended so terribly. But the whole thing is that it's dangerous on these streets. And you know that if you live on these streets, it's dangerous. And so we need a safe place to go to. And when the city closed down 1411 Locust, I'm saying that they had blood on their hands. We already had two people die last year. Now we have all these people who have died. Homeless people are dying because this building is not open and the city closed it. So we need this building back open again so we won't have to be outside. So you have a safe place to go to. And I remember Bobby, I believe Bobby would have came here also if this building had been open. He would have been safe inside this building. We all would have been safe inside this building. And the last thing I want to say is that we deserve better. These individuals on here are somebody's father, somebody's mother, somebody's sister, somebody's brother, somebody's aunt, uncle, nephew, niece, right? Son, daughter, right? Grandson, right? These individuals are human beings, just like we are human beings, and we deserve better. God wants us to have better. The city of St. Louis should be ashamed of themselves.
Thank you.
Amen. And this gentleman brought out a very important point. We can't forget the men. The city makes it sound like they're just taking care of them all at Biddle House. There's so many that remain out on the street. We understand your frustration. We've just got to try to get more places open, don't we? And that's why we're, yes, sir.
I'm sleeping right there by across from Bread, coming the doorway, right there where the old line shows. I've been there for the past 3, 4, maybe five months.
Yeah.
And it ain't getting no better.
All right, well, let's see. Tell everybody your name.
My name is Jamil Atkins.
Jamil, he represents all the men that continue to remain out on the streets at this time.
And we stay taking from each other when we all out here together. Right. We need to stop taking from each other, fighting each other. We all like, we need to stick together because we all out here together.
Right.
So we need to stop bullying each other, start helping one another. What we need to start doing.
Amen.
And no matter what the situation, everybody can go through problems. We all need to work together we all need to come as a family. We a family out here, coach. And nobody's gonna take care of us, so we gotta take care of each other.
And be humble.
And we can't, it all takes one person messing up for everybody. One.
Oh, yeah. Yep.
One person messing up for everybody. That's all it takes.
That's just like cleaning the area up, all this.
All right, let's have a word of prayer. Can you stand up here with me a minute? A man, come up here with you. Let's represent the women. We've got some pastors here. Let's help me pray with some of these individuals that are here with us. And we'll just lay your hands on them and pray for them as we pray for these that still are alive. You know, I prefer not to do memorial services because the people have moved on. I want to keep them alive, don't we?
Yeah.
And there's so many that are still out here. There's so many hurting. And as this individual indicated, and the others, we've got to pull together right now, don't we?
Yes.
We got to support one another. If you, yes, 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 yes. And if you know of homeless people,
judgment is coming.
Yes,
God going to judge all our actions.
Right.
If you know of somebody, we heard about some of these names from people that are homeless.
Yeah, we are being judged. Yes, we are.
Let's go.
We're being judged because you got to clean up, take care of one another, love one another.
Yes, and that's what he called us to do. He said, as oft you've done to the least of these, you've done it to me. Father, I thank you for my brothers and my sisters, Lord God. Some, Lord, are going through unbelievable suffering. They're sleeping outside night after night. They're getting worn down, worn out. And I'm asking you right now in Christ's name to strengthen them and show all of us what we can do right now as we work to get 1411 Locust to open back up. Father, show us what we can do to help them in the midst of the need that they're at. Show us, Lord God, there's so much more that we can do, we must do. We remember those that have gone to you, Lord God. We ask that you would help these that are with us right now. Help us come together, Lord Jesus. For you told us, as oft we've done to the least of these, even so we've done it unto you. Thank you now. Move in our hearts, move in our minds. Lead us, fill us with your power and spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Work together in one another.
Put him in the front of the line for those bus tickets.
That's what I'm saying, though.
Be a family.
We all need to stick together.
Where is it? I didn't know about it.
Every last one needs to stick together.
I was on your team to save it. And then I rewrote, and there's a low over 1,400 signatures.
Okay, listen. This lady wants to say something before you leave. Go ahead.
Pastor Tina, you know me.
Pastor Tina, listen.
Hi again, Pastor Tina Crawford. I have a petition. I was on Reverend Rice's team to save the shelter from closing. I changed it around, and now it's you can just go to my Facebook group, Helping Our OUR Homeless the Refuge, and pull up the petition. It'll take you right there. It literally takes 8 seconds to get in and get out and sign it.
Thank you.
So we already have like over 1,300 signatures.
Praise God.
And I said, I don't care if you live in Argentina, sign it. I want Mayor Lyda Cruzan's eyeballs to go like that.
Amen.
How's that?
God bless you. That's wonderful. I thank God for all of you that are praying for the New Life Evangelistic Center. It is difficult to do a memorial service. We want to help these people before they fall out, down, and die. I thank God for those that are helping. And I thank God for those that are on the front lines with New Life Evangelistic Center that are reaching out, working to be there when people are hurting.
Good morning. This is Nadine Rice. And I thank the Lord for blessing me to be here with Reverend Rice and his staff and all of these people that have volunteered in this cold weather to come out and give gifts and clothes and food and pray for them, all these homeless people. And I just thank the Lord for letting me be a part of this, that I can come out and give my prayers and blessings and help Reverend Rice and his staff to participate and put smiles on these people's face. And whatever you can do to encourage him, please do it. Whether it's a phone call, financial help he needs, clothes, gifts, food, whatever you can do to encourage him with all of these people in this cold weather that's out here and some giving their time to come out and serve and give out gifts and give out food. It's a blessing. And I thank the Lord to being a part of this blessing.
Not bad. How are you?
And he'll bless me.
Yep, a little bit blessed.
For coming out and being with them. And that's where our blessings is. When we can give our time, money, whatever you can give, encouragement to this man walking around in this cold weather to look after these people and give them encouragement, giving out bus tickets and food, clothes, providing places to stay wherever he can. But keep praying that the Lord would allow 11 locals to open back up where we won't have to be outside in the cold, in the rain, and whatever. Continue praying for him. Continue praying for everyone that's volunteering their time. These people are not paid people. These are employees and friends and relatives that's coming out to help him to put a smile on these little children's face that's running around here with no home to go to. But I thank the Lord for blessing me to be a part of this day. And you all continue to pray for me that the Lord will give me strength, keep me lifted up, and to pray for him. Thank you.
Talking with Mike Woolsey. And Mike, you've been out on the front lines now for how many years?
Five years.
Tell us what you find and what motivates you to do this.
Oh, just that people are out there in need and people that just deserve a little bit better comfort and just a better care out there, you know, better spirit of mind and just, you know, someone to talk to, someone that they're not feeling alone or feeling that they're in a spot by themselves like Denise did.
So that's what the Winter Patrol is all about. It's more than just giving out blankets and that, but it's being building relationships.
Exactly. Conversations, rapport. Not just when we pull up and they see that we're out, but that they say, how's your day going? And we talked about how their day's going and just that things are going in a better light and they're still looking forward to tomorrow instead of having to despair of tomorrow.
So are you finding more and more despair out there on the streets?
Lately, it's not been the best attitudes, to be honest. You know, it's, I wouldn't say all despair, but not feeling that comfort, not feeling the blessings as strong as in years past. They're out there, but, you know, not as thick. You know, not as, you know, overwhelming or not as like I said, not as blessed as years past.
How did you get started in this?
Actually, my brother first got me started in this. But in my original actual actions was actually doing food lines, like soup lines at Salvation Army. I did a couple feedings there and then found out my brother was going out to the streets. And I started going out to the streets here at Larry Rice in the end of 13, beginning of 14. And have just enjoyed ever since, and it's a calling in some essences.
And now you're going out with Joe on Wednesday nights. Tell us about that outreach. What do you do on a typical night?
It's outstanding. We, first of all, Facebook live stream, so anybody can watch us on streetpeople.org. You just find the link there and find us any Wednesday night at 6:30 p.m. to usually 12:30 a.m. And we just go out and feed all over the city, whether downtown or East St. Louis or South or North St. Louis, and just feed and clothe everybody we know in their certain spots or other ones we come across, or just people that in need, people that are just happen to be in our path and we come across and bless. And we give out everything from propane to clothing to food to nourishment and anything in between. And just try to bless all our loving sisters and brothers out there.
And you think, you know, somebody may say, well, wow, that's too overwhelming for me to do something like that. What would you say to somebody like that?
No, actually, it's quite simple. And most of what we do is just us just making our hand out there stretched out for the next person. That's all it is. It's just putting your hand out for somebody to be able to take the things we're blessed with. It's not just us that's doing it. It's people that are behind us that don't even come out that, you know, bless us with their donations and just all their spirit and love themselves, you know, whether it's food or clothing or other things.
So I would encourage people that are interested in doing this to contact us here at New Life Evangelistic Center, and we could get you started. You could call 314-421-3020 and tell them you're interested in participating in the Winter Patrol. We can get you started going out with the team like Mike or one of the other teams that go out, and so you can become acquainted with it and really get to do it on a regular basis.
Hi, my name's Pastor Tina Crawford. My group is called
helping our OUR homeless, The Refuge, and I'm an ordained pastor with The Refuge Ministries. We are in 3 countries and 6 states. I started on Reverend Rice's team back in February 2017 to come in and help save the city, help save the shelter from closing down. Wrote the petition. Now I have the petition changed the wording, and it's on change.org, and it says, tell the city to reopen the NLEC, Reverend Rice, Larry Rice's shelter. And I do updates all the time. And I mean, I'm on the streets 365, late at night, early in the morning. It doesn't matter if it's 115 or minus 15 degrees. We're out here. And it's hard. And I don't care what the HUD count says. We have more homeless this year. And we need the shelter desperately. I mean, this is absolutely all. We don't have the shelter because of the mere fact that Mayor Lyda Crewson has made it very publicly known in her statements to 50 reporters and the St. Louis Post-Dispatch that she doesn't believe that the homeless are real. And she wants them out of here so we can have high-rise condominiums. We need to take care of our own people here first before we start bringing in million-dollar buildings. I mean, everything she's done as an alderman, all I can say is her voting trend and her analysis has shown to cut disproportionately into the lives of the Black community, the homeless, and the poor. And when asked why, she says, I don't know if you want to call it that, but I call it political clout. And I don't think that's right. We're talking about human beings. We're all the same. There's no difference except I have a roof over my head. That's it. So they're homeless people are different. I don't see any difference in us at all. So that's all I'm saying. Go to my page on Facebook called Helping Our OUR Homeless, The Refuge, and you will find the petition to reopen the shelter. Thanks. I appreciate it.
Ray, you were there at the memorial service with me. Wow. What touched you?
Well, it was you know, so many different people are helping. I thank God for that. Sometimes feel like you're all alone, but it's good to see that and to know that so much more can be done as more people become involved praise God that we can get this building open again at 1411 Locust, because we can help people in a much greater way with the building. I thank God that we can go out to where they are, but it's so important for them for the homeless to have a place that they know they can turn to when they need to, and that's why we want to get the building open.
Well, please be a part of what God is doing at this time and help us to help the homeless, help those that are still out there alive, and we don't want to see more names added, but there's so many that are being added to the list. We're asking you just to continue to pray for us at New Life Evangelistic Center. Share your much-needed tax-deductible gifts that are urgently needed now. It's P.O. Box 473, St. Louis, Missouri. That's 63166. Follow New Life Evangelistic Center on Facebook. Go to our website at nlecstl.org. We thank God for each and every one of you that are praying, caring, and sharing as we move into this new year.